look at all the things going on in the world today, and man, what in the world? What is the answer? I think the sign that I told you about, the Jesus 2020, is the answer. That's the reality of it. That's what's wrong with the world. That's, you know, we can pin all kind of thoughts and ideas as to what's going on and why it's going on, and this caused that, and that caused this, but the bottom line is sin is ever present in our world, and this is the result of it. This is what happens. When you have a godless society, a godless nation, then this is the result. I don't know, you know, sometimes why we would expect anything any different than what we're seeing right now. We've got a generation of people that have been brought up not to fear God, not to respect people, and that's what's going on. You know, for us, some of us here, maybe older ones and some of the younger ones that have been brought up in the church that understand biblical teachings, it seems appalling. Like, what is wrong with people? Why would you do that? Why would you act that way? Why would you treat someone that way? Why would you talk to someone that way? Why would you be disrespectful? Because unfortunately, that's just where we are. That's the society that we have. The basics are just not there. And that's also a sign of the times. You'd have to be just blind not to see that where we are in the world as a whole. The signs of the times are the things that are going to transpire with the coming of the Lord. But what is the answer to all this? Jesus 2020. That's the answer. That would cure all the problems we have if people would just give their heart to Christ. If people would just come to know the Lord in their life and allow Him to change their way of thinking. You know, that's what it's supposed to do. If you came to Christ and you haven't changed your way of thinking, you might better come back to the altar and pray through again, because God should have changed your mindset, changed who you are and how you look at things, because it makes a difference. It's supposed to be a difference there. What are we talking about today? That, the Savior of sinners. That's the answer. This is the cure. Get people to know Christ. Because once you know Christ, then guess what? The Bible says all things become new. Behold, all things, old things, they all pass away. You become a new creature in Christ. You have a new way of thinking, a new outlook on life, a new outlook on how you talk and treat other people. It makes a difference. Here we're going to talk about this morning the great love of Jesus towards sinful man and the love for which we should have, excuse me, toward the Lord, and our response to that should be from the heart. Scripture this morning comes from Luke 7, 36 through 38, and then 40 through 46. I'm going to read through that. It says, and one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. Here Christ is, and the Pharisee is desired of him to come and to eat with him. And Christ grants that, says that he will, and he goes to his house to sit down to eat. It says, behold, a woman in the city which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment, and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. See, this is taking place. Jesus is there. This woman's come in. Now, the Pharisees, you realize they were the religious top of the chain, so to speak, back then. They really thought they had it together. They were it. And so, you know, in Simon's mind, he's thinking, man, does he even realize what manner of woman this is? Does he realize who this is that's just come into my house? He's probably a little upset anyway that she even came into his home. And now here she is, and this is his guest, and she is washing his guest's feet. She's anointing him and doing all these things with this ointment, putting the ointment on him. And Simon's probably a little bit beside himself in this situation. Not only because she's doing these things, but because of who she is. You know, there's people in this world that would not take charity from someone just because of who they are. Didn't that seem crazy? There would be people that are truly in need and would not take help from someone just because of who they are. Seems insane, doesn't it? But you know what? Some people think that way. But here she is, and she's doing all this, and Jesus says unto Simon, he says, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he saith, Master, say on. Says, there was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence, the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him most. He's trying to get him to think a little bit. Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, Thou hast judged rightly. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, Seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house. Thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. He's trying to get him to understand something here. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. The parable here was spoken to a Pharisee, one of the religious groups of that day. It's important to look at the entire incident in order to grasp the full meaning of the parable that Jesus spoke here. The parable shows the sharp contrast of self-righteousness, which is the Pharisee. They were known for that. They were self-righteous. They thought they had it all together, had it all figured out. And then also the difference between that and sorrowful repentance. That's what the woman had. That's where she was at. She realized who he was, and in turn, she realized who she was. And she realized where she was at and the need that she had through Christ. You know, that's the difference of the man. You remember there, the Pharisees again. The Pharisee was praying, Lord, I thank God that I'm not like this man. And remember, he was over there beating his chest and crying out to God, have mercy on me, a sinner. That's the same thing that we're looking at here, is the mindset of someone that is self-righteous and has a prideful way about them versus someone that is that reality and realizes their need for Christ, their need for forgiveness. If you ever get to the place in your religious experience with Christ that you just think you've got it all together and you're all that, buddy, you better be careful, because Bible says pride goeth before what? Before fall. We have to realize every day that we need his grace. We need his grace. We're going to make mistakes. Me and a good friend of mine, good Christian man, we had a little bit of a tiff this last week because of the way that he treated me on something. It really got to me, and I'm sorry. I had to ask him to forgive me. I had to ask God to forgive me. I get a little bit sideways when I feel like somebody is treating me wrong. I don't know why. I've just always been that way. I don't deal well with that. But some things went on, most of it was just not communicating. And then what do we do as human beings? We begin to process things of our own thoughts of what we think went down. Well, we really don't know what really happened. We think this is what happened. And because there was no communication there, there's a misunderstanding. But it's all good now. But you know what? He just said, hey, I just need grace. I just need grace right now. Because he made some mistakes. We all make mistakes. And I told you that. We all make mistakes. But we've got to make it right. But here, when you get that mindset, I'm this and I'm that, you better be careful. It says, true love for the Lord is shown not by an arrogant attitude of self-righteousness or self-sufficiency, but in humility and sacrifice. As we study today, we should all take personal inventory of our lives to see if our love for Jesus has grown cold. Has our attitude become one of a prideful arrogance, or have we maintained our relationship with the Lord in love and humility? Many are so proud of their humility. True humility is a sign of a real Christian. Have you ever had a debt forgiven? Can you imagine how you would feel if tomorrow your bank called and told you that your loan no longer had to be paid? Hey, if you're struggling, if you're going through a hard time, you'd be like, man, this is phenomenal. This is awesome. I was trying to figure out how I was going to pay this thing anyway, and now I don't have to pay it. So you'd be pretty ecstatic about it. It was a race from the books. Would you be beside yourself with excitement? Would you rush to the bank to find the one responsible for this unbelievable act of generosity and thank him profusely? You would tell your family, friends, neighbors, co-workers, and just about everyone else about this great person and what they had done for you. Do you realize he paid a debt he didn't owe? Do you realize this morning you owe a debt you couldn't pay? Did it mean something to you? Did it mean what it would mean here in the normal realm of life? If someone forgave you a $100,000 debt, buddy, you'd be pretty excited about it, wouldn't you? Seemed like you would. But guess what? Someone's forgive you something far greater than that. Something we could not pay. There's no way we could pay for the price of sin. We should be excited about it. We should want to tell everyone else about this great person and what they've done. Today's lesson will show us all that we all have been forgiven of a great debt, and we should express our love and devotion to the one who paid it for us. Here we meet a man named Simon who was a Pharisee. The Pharisees, one of the two prominent religious groups of their day. They were the ones who had written extensive interpretation of the law and demanded strict adherence to it. Isn't that crazy how people do that? We have it today in society. It's called politics. What are they doing? They have their version of what they think the law says, and then they want strict adherence to it. They want us to follow it to the letter, but yet they themselves don't even do it. Here, the same thing with the Pharisees. They were a religious group. They wrote their interpretation of the law. They demanded strict adherence to it. They, in effect, had written their own law. They were not satisfied to simply obey God's law, but insisted that everyone obey their interpretation of God's law. Therefore, they felt themselves to be better than anyone else who would have nothing to do with those who were not Pharisees. I've always been blown away by the mindset of people, especially Christians, that think they're better than someone else. I cannot, for the life of me, figure that out. What gives us the right to look at someone else and feel like, because maybe we're closer to God, that we can look down at them? I've never understood that. I've never understood that in life. I don't care if you're a multimillionaire. You're no better than anybody else. You just have been blessed and you are fortunate. Why would you even begin to look down on someone else that is less fortunate? I don't understand that mindset. Maybe it's me. I just can't get it. It doesn't make sense to me. You put your pants on the same way I do. You stand up on your 2 feet every morning and thank the Lord that you can, just like I do. So what gives people a mindset to think that they're better than someone? And here we are with the Pharisees. That's what they did. They took the law. It wasn't enough that we had the law. They wanted to write their interpretation of the law. And then you had to adhere to it the way that they saw it. Or guess what? You didn't fit the part. They looked down on you. But hey, that's just the way they were back then. And guess what? We see it today the same way. It says, therefore, they felt themselves to be better. I don't understand that, but people still today. So much to the point that anyone else, they were better than anyone else and would have nothing to do with those who are not Pharisees. They'd have no contact whatsoever with sinners of their community. They would not speak to them even in greeting. Have you ever had someone snub their nose at you? It's a little irritating, isn't it? I don't like it. I had a woman one time. She was a very pretty woman. I'm not going to say she was. She was gorgeous. Went to hold the door for her, and she just kind of threw her head up and looked at me like, I better. I let it go. Sorry. I don't work that way. Don't act like you're deserving of something like that. Don't look at me like I'm nothing because you think you're something. I don't understand that. My mind doesn't work that way. But a lot of people, it does. They would not touch them, and went to great pains to avoid even an accidental touch. Of course, when Jesus began to preach and gain popularity with the people, the Pharisees immediately considered him their enemy. Not only would they not believe his teachings, they made every possible effort to stop his ministry and to destroy him. You know what? People don't like change. They don't like change in the church. They don't like change in the world. They don't like change in the job. People don't like change. They just don't. That's just human nature for some reason. We get settled in our ways, and this is just the way we do it. We've got a thing at work that says it's the way we've always done it, with a circle around it with a slash through it, because that's always been the mindset. That's all. Why are we doing it like this? Well, that's just the way we've always done it. Yeah, but it's not really a great idea, but that's just the way we've always done it. People don't like change. People get set in their ways. Somewhat curious then that this Pharisee would invite Jesus to his house for dinner. But when he did give such an invitation, Jesus accepted and went to his house. It says the Pharisees were the main religious group in the day of Jesus. They were legalistic in the true sense of the word. They required strict adherence not to the law of God itself, but to their interpretation of it. You remember Paul addressed a lot of that when they were trying to get the Jews that had converted to Christianity to adhere to the law. Remember, they were trying to say they had to be circumcised, they had to be this, they had to keep that. Same type of deal here with the Pharisees. They were having their interpretation, and they were trying to get people to adhere to their interpretation of the law. It says here, they were so proud and self-righteous that they wanted no social contact whatsoever with those who were not of their sect. The Pharisee avoided as far as possible any contact with the non-Pharisee, because the latter was to him of the unclean. Therefore, they found fault with the associations that Jesus had with the publicans and the sinners. Here's where they had the problem. They would have nothing to do with the publicans. They would have nothing to do with the sinners. They didn't want anything to do with the sick, with the lame, with the blind, whatever it may be. And here Christ comes along, and he has something to do with all of this. He's come to save. He's come to heal. And that's not what they were doing. So this goes completely against everything that they had been teaching, everything that they had been doing, and everything they had been professing in their lives. They had nothing to do with these people. So this was in stark contrast to what they were doing. It says they found fault with the associations that Jesus had with these people. It was an unusual request that Jesus received from Simon to come for dinner at his home. He may have been curious about Jesus, or he may have even wanted a chance to argue with him or to mock him. Whatever reason for the invitation, Jesus accepted and went to his home to eat. It's important to notice the shameful neglect of Simon in regard to common matters of hospitality. And according to Manners and Customs of the Bible by James Freeman, these things were a matter of common courtesy. See, here's some things that Simon overlooked. These are things that this lady did that should have been done by the host. This was common courtesy. This is what you did in Bible times. One, providing water for washing the feet. You know, that seems kind of a weird thing to wash feet, but if you think about when this came about, this was your mode of travel. That's it. I mean, other than getting on the back of a camel or a donkey, that was it. The majority of the people, we used to call them Pat and Turner. That's it, you walked. So guess what? When you wore sandals and you were in a dry desert climate, guess what happened to your feet? I just got on Mason yesterday. I needed one of the bits. Brother Henry, any of you ever done any construction work, Kevin? I needed a bit for the roof screws. And I had two brand new ones I had bought a while back, and they were laying on the counter in the kitchen. And so I'm out there on the ladder, and I said, Mason, go in the house. You know where Papa's bowl is? I've got a bowl. I throw change in it. I throw receipts in it. Who knows what's in that bowl? But I throw everything in the bowl. I said, they're right by. They're either in the bowl or by the bowl. And I look down, and he's barefooted out there in the yard. And his feet are just as nasty. It's been raining and everything. I said, clean your feet before you go in the house because your nanny's going to get on you if you don't. So he takes off. You know why? Because he's barefooted. He's out there in the dirt. Well, that's the same thing with them years ago. Their feet got dirty. So it was customary. It was something you were supposed to do to provide them with washing of the feet. Two, a kiss of greeting. That was common courtesy then. That's the way that they greeted one another. It was common custom for men to greet each other with a kiss. A lot of your, I don't know if it's the Italians or Greeks or who it is, you see a lot of, they still do it to this day. You'll see it on television. They still do the same thing to this day. Three, anointing with a mixture of oil and fragrance. Guests were always given an anointing of perfume as a sign that they were welcome in the home. Simon neglected all of these things when Jesus came in as his guest. Makes you really wonder what was the intention of Simon to bring him there to begin with. Gavest me no water for his feet. Christ addressed this with him. Thou gavest me no kiss, and with oil thou did not anoint. He brings all these to his attention. But the woman here, which was a sinner, says here this woman in this account we meet is a woman whom Luke clearly states was a sinner. It was evidently common knowledge that this woman was a sinner. And Luke said that she was. Simon said that she was. Jesus himself even said that she was. But this woman came into the dinner uninvited and no doubt received many hateful looks. But she would probably have been bodily removed if Jesus had not been there. I wonder if Christ hadn't been there, what would they have done? She heard that Jesus was here in his house and came to worship. The woman comes uninvited, of course. She was known throughout the town as a sinner. So says Luke in the writing account. So said Simon. So said Christ. She was known as a sinner. Why did she come? Why do you think she came there? I think the same reason that many of us. She heard that Christ was there, began to know who he was, and realized her need, and came to worship him. See, that's the thing. If people, you know, it's, if you can get people's mind to realize where they are, you know, that's, I think, the biggest deterrent to get people to come to Christ is them to understand the need to know Christ? How many people do you know today that just don't feel like they need to know Christ? They don't feel like they need to have a relationship with Him. You know, many times tragedy brings people to Christ, does it not? Because then they realize their vulnerability and they realize just how fragile life is in this world. And then they begin to understand that need for something else, that need for someone that we can lean on, that need for that high tower, that need for that rock, that need for that place of refuge. You know, that's what the times that we that know Christ realize we have that. We realize we have a rock to stand on. We realize we have a place of refuge. We realize He can hide us during the storm. We realize we draw our strength from Him. Maybe she's seen all that in Him and realized her need for Christ in her life. She came in repentance. Think about that. She came weeping and crying. She realized, you know what, when you're in the presence of the Lord, what happens? A lot of things begin to be revealed, don't they? Oh, when you feel the power of God beginning to come down in a service, man, things begin to happen because people begin to realize where they are. She came in weeping and crying. You ever came weeping and crying? I cried the night I gave my heart to the Lord. I sat there at that dinner table. I'll never forget it, long as I live, May the 1st, 1994. Sat down right there, Midge is making biscuits and gravy and whatever else, and she's got tea on the table, and Brother Harry's sitting right there, and we're just sitting there, and we're just talking, and me and Lisa hadn't been to church in just a couple times, and I mean, I'd been to church when I was a kid, but you know how that goes. And it just began to weigh on my mind. That spirit began to move, and I sat there, and I just started crying. He said, "Son, what's the matter?" And I said, "If I was to die tonight, I don't know where I'd go." He just laughed. I'll never forget it. Brother Doug just looked at me. He just kind of chuckled a little bit. He said, "Ah, that ain't no problem." He got up. He walked right down that little hallway right in there to his desk. He got that Bible. He came back and he set it on that table. He flipped it open, read something out of Romans, asked me if I believed in the Lord. He said, "Yeah, I believe." I said, "You got to ask Him to forgive you your sins?" "Yes, sir." Did all that right there, just that simple. But you know what? I came to a place that I realized who He was and that I had a need to know Him. I didn't want to leave this world lost. I didn't want to leave this world not knowing where I would go. Maybe that's what came through her mind. She came in humility. The tears show that. You know, you can't walk through that door, old lost, rugged, rotten, raunchy sinner, and just come walking in here, "Well, I guess I need God to save me." Ain't gonna work. You got to realize where you are. You got to come in and say, "Father, forgive me, for I'm a sinner." I mean, I think about the thief on the cross. What did he do? He looked over there and he saw the other man that was guilty. Realized, hey, he's just like I am. We're guilty. Then he saw Christ and he said, "Wait a minute, something's going on here. This man's different than the other man." And he realized then his shortcomings. And he began to think about his life and what he had done. And he deserved to die, but this man didn't. And he recognized it. In what? In humility. She stood behind him, knelt at his feet. Excuse me. She was weeping so that her tears ran in rivers and cascaded onto his dusty feet. She began to wash his feet with her tears and wipe them with her hair. So also she kissed his feet, which was an act of reverence and affection. She humbled herself at his feet, not caring that others were watching her. She was of a broken and contrite spirit. You ever been to that place? You don't really care what anybody else thinks. You don't really care what anybody else is looking at you or not looking at you. That's when you'll make your most headway, is when you let everything else disappear and you concentrate on Him. You know, we sing that song. What did it say? Concentrate on Him and what? And worship Him. So many times it's hard for us to concentrate. We come into the church so loaded down with the daily cares of life, everything we had going on yesterday and everything we got to go on tomorrow. And it's hard for us to get our mind just on Him. She came in sacrifice. She brought with her an alabaster box of ointment. She had planned this anointing ahead. She deliberately brought something of great value to her with her to show her sincere devotion to the Lord. No doubt the fragrance of the ointment filled the room as they all looked on with amazement at what was happening. Now here Simon was appalled at the scene before him. He was still in shock that this woman had dared enter into his house at all, and especially at this time when his friends and fellow Pharisees were here to see it. Now she was putting on a show in front of them all, and the scene filled Simon with horror. He begins to talk to himself, this man, if he were a prophet, would know or have known who and what manner of woman this is. Do you know you still got people that think that way today? Do you know there's some people that they, a sinner, the town drunk, whoever you want to call him, come walking through that door, and you begin to minister to him, they'd look at you and say, man, don't you know who that guy is? Don't you realize who he is? Don't you realize it shouldn't matter? You know, that's still a soul. So that's the thing people have to get a hold of. It's just, that's a soul. That man on the corner down there. You know, there was a country song years ago that talked about that. Don't laugh at me. Don't call me names. Don't get your pleasure from my pain. And what he was talking about is he was there holding that cardboard sign. But you don't know what put him there. You don't know what happened to get him to that place. But so many times people want to pass judgment on somebody just because of where they are without any idea of what got them there. And this song talked about a man that a car crossed the center line and killed his family. I've never been through that. I'd hope and pray that I could hold on and go the way I'm supposed to go, but you don't know till you've experienced it for yourself. So we're not to look at other people and be judgmental in that way. This guy's saying if he was a prophet, surely he'd know what man or woman this is. See what we're talking about here, that mindset of the Pharisee? There's no humility there. It says here, Simon, I have somewhat to say. Simon had not spoken aloud, but he might as well, for Jesus heard him loud and clear. For Luke says, and answered him, Jesus spoke to him just as if he were responding to a verbal question. Jesus knew who the woman was. He knew full well who she was. And answered him, he spoke to him and said, hey, I know who this woman is. I know what's going on in your mind. Remember the others when they would do things like that, they were saying stuff in their mind and he would answer them when he was there teaching? Answered him, he spoke to him just as he responded to a verbal question. Jesus knew who the woman was better than anyone there. He knew she was a sinner. He knew that she needed a Savior. When Jesus was reviled for being the guest of Zacchaeus, he replied, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save what? That which is lost. Guys, you got it wrong. You're looking at this thing the wrong way. You don't need to worry about what manner of woman this is. You need to understand and realize she needs a Savior. I'm a Savior. I came to save that which was lost. That's what I came to do. Do you not understand my mission? Do you not understand why the Father sent me? This is exactly why I'm here. I've come to save that which is lost. When people began to criticize and critique and look at his ministry, they're just not understanding what is the purpose. What's the purpose of the church? What's the purpose of why we're here today? What's the purpose of the place of the church in the world? It's to save, to seek out, to bring the lost in. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We're not out there to be judgmental. We're not out there to look at someone and think, oh man, look at this bum, or look at this, or look at that. But so many people get this wrong and they have the Pharisee mindset. He said in John 3:17 that God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world. You know, a lot of people have that mindset. They go out there and they want to condemn people for the life they're living. I had an uncle, I've told y'all many times, he could pick, you could call him on the phone and he could quote this book cover to cover. I kid you not, there were times that I thought he was reading out the Bible. He wasn't. It was in his mind. He knew it that well. But you know what his number one thing he liked to do? Condemn people. He'd tell you, you're going to go to hell for this. You're going to go to hell for that. You're going to go to hell for that. You're going to go to hell for living in adultery. I had my niece one time call me just bawling. Uncle Roger told me this, told me that, and I'm going to go to hell for this, and I'm going to go to hell for that. And I'm like, I called him. I said, what is wrong with you? Why are you, that's not doing anybody any good. You know, in reality, the only thing we're going to go to hell for is a sin of unbelief, not believing upon the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what sends you to hell. All the other is just a result of not knowing him. That's what that is. So many times people get it mixed up. You know what? When you're lost, guess what you do? You do things that lost people do. When you're out in sin, what do you do? You commit sin. That's not what's going to send you to hell. What's going to send you to hell is because you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. But he sent his Son not into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. People like this woman were the reason Jesus came. May God help us never to become so self-righteous that instead of reaching for the sinner, we roughly push him away. Remember how Simon refused to perform the common acts of hospitality? Simon, a dignified man, a man of position and rank, yet he acted as a man with no class. Why? Because here is a sinner woman who's considered by Simon and the others present to be an outcast. They don't even consider her to be anything, and yet she was more hospitable to Christ than they were. And they're supposed to be the religious sect of the day. They're supposed to be all that in a bag of chips, as Brother Jamie says. And what did they do? They failed to even give common courtesy to Christ. She's the one showing the courtesy, the devotion, and that was to be expected. She washed his feet, she kissed him, and anointed him. The thought of it should shame the religious proud who refuse to worship Jesus Christ, the Lord, even when they attend his house. Some people are too dignified. I wrote a song years ago. It said, could someone raise a hand in praise? Don't see much of that these days. Seems we're all too dignified. The reality, some people are too dignified. I'm not making a scene. I'm telling you, it's reality, folks. It goes on in the church. There's people out there that call themselves religious that I'm not going to be outspoken. I'm not going to raise my hand. I'm not going to the altar. I don't need to go to the altar. I'm just fine. People think that way. I mean, it's reality. We see it. Why? Because the Pharisees thought that way. The thought of it would shame the religious proud who refuse to worship Jesus Christ even in his house. They do not honor his presence as they should, and often it is the outcast that brings to him the glory due his name. Then what does he go on? He goes to tell Simon the story about the two debtors. What is the purpose of this? To get him to understand about forgiveness and what it means. You know what? If you owed someone $5 and they said, "Hey, don't worry about it. It's all good. Draven, I ain't worried about $5. Okay, whatever. No big deal." But if you owed them $5,000, it might mean a little bit more. But you know what we owe? We owe him everything. Without him, we'd be nothing. Without him, we'd be lost. What Christ gave to you and I, money can't pay back. All the good deeds in the world can't pay it back. Because he provided for something for us that we had no other way to attain except through his shed blood on the cross. That's it. There's no other way to have obtained this. And Christ wanted Simon to understand what this meant, this forgiveness. He addresses Simon, tells him a short, simple parable, which is the story of the debtors and what was owed. It says here, it's approximately $75 to the one and $7.50 to the other. So about 10 times difference here. It says the two men were in debt, one for 500 pence, one for 50. The linguistic key to New Testament says that a pence was the working man's average daily wage. That's a lot. A day's pay. They had nothing to pay, but were totally forgiven. Colossians 2 and 13, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all your trespasses? What's that worth? 1 John 1 and 19, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Third here says Isaiah 55 and 7, let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts and let him return unto the Lord. And what's going to happen? He'll have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Isaiah 43 and 25, I am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for mine own sake and will not remember thy sins. Did you hear what he said there? He's doing it not because of you, for his own sake. He did this for us. And what will he say? I'll blot them out. And I'm not going to remember them against you. Don't let the devil keep throwing it up in your face. Because that's all it is. God's forgive you. It's over. It's done. Let it go. I never could understand people say, well, I forgive them, but I ain't forgot about it. Then you ain't forgave them. Because once you truly forgive, what does he say here? It's never to be remembered again. I think that's one of the things that people have a really hard time dealing with is forgiving people. True forgiveness forgets it. Let it go. You can't keep bringing it back up. I've tried to tell young people that in relationships. Well, you know, I just don't, you know what? Until you can let it go, you've not forgiven it. It says here, thinking of the meaning of pardon, it's a criminal escape from prison. If he is free in a sense, but he must always be afraid of being recaptured. You know what? You escape from prison, you feel like you're free, but in reality, you know you're not free because any time they could catch you and you're going to have to go back to prison. Can you imagine if we came down to the altar and we prayed through and asked God to forgive us of all our sins and we felt like we were saved, but at any time somebody could come around and point it back out? Oh, no, you went down here and you prayed, but I know what you did. That wouldn't be no fun, would it? You wouldn't have any peace, any joy with that, would you? The Bible says it's forgiven, it's forgotten, it's far as the east is from the west. It says here, he must always be afraid of being recaptured, but if he is pardoned, then he's no longer guilty at all. The dictionary says that pardon is an exemption of a convicted person from the penalties of an offense or a crime by the power of the executor of the laws. An official document or warrant declaring such an exemption, allowance or forgiveness for an offense or discourtesy. Goes on about the debtors, they had nothing to pay. Neither one of them could pay this. No way, no how. Even though the $750 seemed like maybe not near as much as the $75 or the $5 and the $50, it didn't matter. When you're both broke, you're both broke. It don't matter what you owe. If we go to the Mexican restaurant tonight and Draven orders a $50 meal and I order a $500 meal and ain't neither one's got a dime in our pocket, it really don't matter because we're both in trouble. Because neither one of us can pay it. Regardless what's owed, we neither one can pay it. That's what he was trying to get him to understand. You know what? It don't matter how deep in sin you are. It doesn't matter how far you've gone. You're still a sinner versus the guy over here says, well, I ain't really done much wrong. Well, guess what? You can't pay it no more than the man that's deep in sin. What did he do? He forgave them both. The creditor had every right to employ whatever punishment he desired and exact whatever amounts he could from them and their family. He had them totally at his mercy, but he forgave them both. What an act of grace. One writer said, he made them a present of what they owed. We must realize that we are all in the same condition. When a person is a sinner, he owes a debt he could never pay. He's bankrupt. Some try to ignore the debt. Others think they can decrease the debt by doing some good deeds or good things, while others ask for more time. The fact is, forgiveness cannot be earned or bought. The good news is, though, that Jesus already paid the debt when he shed his precious blood on Calvary. He says to those who come to him in repentance, the same thing he said to the sinful woman that day, thy sins are forgiven. You being dead in your sins, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. You know, we get a different mindset when we realize what it means. It says, those who have been forgiven of such a great debt should love the Lord more. Why do we take for granted the forgiveness of our debt when our hearts should cry out in gratitude and love, thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me what did he give us? Salvation, so full and so free. It's a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. God's forgiven us a great debt. May not be as much to you as maybe it was to someone else. Maybe someone comes in here and, buddy, they're just emotional and they're just worshiping and they're just praising God. And maybe God's forgive them of something that's happened we don't know anything about. But to them, they realize the importance. They realize what it's worth. And they praise. You know, every time we come in, we ought to thank God. Thank God. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. I thank you for your forgiveness, God. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your mercy. You know, every morning I get up out of bed, that's what I do. Every morning I say, thank you, Lord, for another day. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your keeping power. Thank you for your love. We've got to keep that in mind. or we become like Simon the Pharisee there, as he didn't make sense to him, but to the sinner woman, buddy, she had it figured out. She knew. Amen. We're out of time.